Tetreault's transcultural teams. So Chantal Tetreault is a linguistic and cultural anthropologist whose work generally focuses on issues of language, migration, and social change, and particularly these issues in the context of France. So it explores questions around how cultural processes of identity construction related to things such as gender, ethnicity, are achieved through everyday language use, particularly how new social identities emerge in relationship to the innovative linguistic forms of their speakers. For example, Dr. Tetreault analyzes a number of instances of crossing when individuals adopt and transform linguistic styles across different ethnic and national boundaries. So the context here is North Africans in France. And a lot of people don't realize that France has such a significant North African migrant population. If you think about French imperialism and the French Empire, there have long been ties between the countries of North Africa, Morocco, Algeria, Tunisia, Libya, Egypt, and France proper. And so through time, as you can see here on the chart, 2002, you know, some 30% of immigrants to France are coming from North Africa. Almost twice, let's say, the migrants coming from areas of the world like Asia. And North Africans in France are often associated with what's known as the banlieue, or we can think of it as a suburban housing area, suburban housing district, where many of these migrants have been given state-based housing, but often have high levels of unemployment. So it has a large concentration of people who, on the one hand, are poor, have low income, and then who have major obstacles such as discrimination defining unemployment. And so they're associated with things like high crime levels, violence, informal economy, and things like drugs and so on. You know, despite this, though, as you can imagine, in terms of a migrant area in France, it's a very rich language context. So because France is not the first language of many of the immigrant families, there is a non-standard French that's spoken in the banlieues, that's spoken among North African migrants. And so one could analyze the structure, right, of this language variety and could talk about how Arabic has influenced non-standard French through things like borrowing and other kinds of influences, as well as interesting, unique phenomena to the French context, so that these populations are known also for mixing into their non-standard French a code like Verlan. Verlan, again, very distinct and unique to this setting, that the immigrants are playing with the language. So they're often moving syllables in words in a playful sense. So, for example, Verlan itself is a word that has been modified by North Africans. So the term, literally, inversion, the English term to move syllables around, anver, Verlan. You have the anverse, anver, gets switched. The syllables, the first syllable of the word and the second syllable get reversed. In fact, reversion of syllables is a universal feature of language change. We see that happen in languages throughout the world. But it's interesting that it's a very conscious part of non-standard French. Here's a couple samples. Ik ben met Algerino, draag geen Valentino. Deze dagen draag ik alleen Louboutin. Loops. Die dikke stack, broeder, fuck mijn ex. Ik fuck kan it. Niet hangen meer met de Boutin. Ik kom van de streets en daar is het warm. Hey. Dus ik nam de benen, ik ben niet meer arm. Ben nu miljonair, het heeft tijd gekost. Ik weet wat ik wil, ik zie jij twijfelt nog. Kom uit zanden nu, dat zijn buiten... Wat
Raconte-moi, c'est vrai ou pas? Notre histoire est finie, bébé, à cause de moi. Je suis resté ici, ne m'en veux pas. J'ai du mal à accepter que je suis loin de toi. T'es rentré dans ma vie, t'as comblé le vide, yeah. Tu m'as fait que rêver, non. Bébé, ouais, le fait c'est vrai.
يا عمري شحال نبغيك ونموت على عينيك نقطع البحر ونجيك واللي ليا العقل غاب معاك وانا كان استناك وقتاش نكون حداك واللي ليا.
Transcultural teens, right? This is the ethnography in question. And so she's looking at how the language of Algerian French, or French Algerian youth, primarily adolescents, sort of build their own unique identity. So as something, let's say, distinct from Algerians or Arabs or Muslims generally, also something distinct and unique from French dominant or mainstream culture, that they sort of, through how they use their language, they construct and express something that's distinctly theirs. One of the things that she looks at is that because they're an immigrant population, migrant population, there is quite a bit of stigma and marginalization, as we saw within the case of the Banlieue, at a structural level of society. They face many obstacles to being, you know, an empowered and equal participant in French society. And so when we start to observe how they use language and how they construct their own identity, it's very interesting how they've negotiated that stigma and marginalization. So they have crossed the stereotypes in complex ways, where they will be socialized into speaking French, and thus they do reproduce certain aspects of speaking about, let's say, Algerian migrants and so on, at the same time that they are seen to challenge other aspects of those stereotypes, other aspects of their stigma and marginalization. So one of the interesting examples of this was the way that they negotiate stereotypes of the lazy Arab. So North African migrants in France also face a similar stereotype to migrants throughout the world, and that would be the lazy migrant, right, who's just looking for a handout, let's say, who doesn't want to work and so on. So in the one example in the book, there was this tutoring center, and there were a number of young Algerian French youth that are there. They're studying for an English class, and there is this verbal interaction between Muhammad, an adult mentor of Moroccan parentage, who, in response to somebody calling them over, says, you know, work a bit instead of calling me over. That's how it is with Arabs. Are you an Arab or not? Here, actually, the reflection kind of seen in this language is an inversion, actually, of the way that French sometimes refer to or stereotype Arabs as lazy. And here, in fact, are you an Arab or not? That's how it is with Arabs, is in fact, we are hardworking, and we don't just depend on the assistance of others. So she notes, right, in this ethnography, lots of these moments where the community, right, is negotiating stereotypes. Sometimes they do it in ways which truly reproduce the stereotypes. So they're not outside of socialization processes. They're not outside of dominant French society. And they are subject, right, to the pressures and influences of that society. But they are able to, through their use of language sometimes, exert agency and, right, and to overturn and cross those stereotypes and develop new ones. One of the ways you can see the kind of creativity of their language use is around things called parental name calling. So very interesting example in the ethnography is the way that they transform an Arabic name taboo. So within their own households, if the household is bilingual and it's Arabic speaking, or if it is a household that speaks French at home but has non-standard variety with a lot of Arabic influence, there's a name taboo that you would not speak the name of your parents, and generally the name of elders. And this is an important part of being an Arab Muslim, is to not articulate the names of one's parents, or the names of other people's parents, or just, as I said, of elders generally. And so what is interesting is when you observe using ethnography in this text, you see that the youth, because they are children of migrants, they're immigrants, so they have a unique relationship to Arabic culture, as well as the fact that because they're migrants, they also face a unique relationship to dominant French society, that they have their own way of using parental names. So they have solidarity amongst each other in that they do utter parental names amongst each other. So they wouldn't do that in the household, right, with their family. But they will do that with each other through a kind of ritualized conflict where they use the name of each other's parents. So it's a really interesting example because they're taking a norm of language, a norm of speech, and a taboo, in fact, for respectful address, right? So you addressed your parents by parental terms, kin terms, rather than their names, as to express respect for them. But by using the name of each other's parents, they create a kind of transgressive way of conflicting and struggling with each other, teasing each other, trying to incite anger, really to exert control over the other person in a kind of interaction. The only way to understand this is, right, is understand the broader context, understand the Arab socialization processes, to understand French socialization processes, and then the kind of unique place, right, or location of Algerian French youth, right, in it. So we're looking at this ethnography because it is an example of this contemporary scholarship in language socialization. And I think in a way it offers us a new way of thinking about language and socialization in ways that go beyond, let's say, some of the terms that we used last week when we were thinking about Kaluli or Bosavi language socialization around, let's say, kin terms or distinctive ways of saying things for sharing and distribution. Or if we were looking at, let's say, the Moroccan migrants to Spain, we looked at another example last week. And in both of those examples, it was very much the kind of referential semantic components of language that were at the heart of the discussion. But here, we really need to introduce a new concept of indexicality, because in fact, what's happening here is language is really indexing, if you will. It's not this simple, just what the words mean, but the action that's happening through the use of words and how they index things. They index external levels of meaning, external kinds of ideas, external kinds of ideologies, if you will, that are crucial for understanding the way people are identifying, right? The active kind of process of identification. So by observing closely the language use, recording, observing it very closely, anthropologists can recognize, right, the agency of participants in the socialization process. sure, they are thinking and aligning in ways with society. So very much in the previous example, they are thinking and behaving in ways that align with Arab society and its norms. But they're also modifying that, and they're changing it. They're changing that society, starting to act outside of its constraints, right? Developing kind of new customs, new rules, and so on, which has really been the heart of our conversation. So to conclude, we are bringing a new ethnographic case study to the discussion of language socialization with Tetreault's Transcultural Teens. The context is language socialization and French-Algerian youth identity. And you can see important concepts that we've been talking about, things like agency, change, and a new term, indexicality, as language socialization processes play out there.